Wow. Zoom is very helpful to see prayers.
I know. It is. Actually, I put you on the list now. I started this last June. I was, I've been on a one-year leave, so I was really missing everything. So I started this, and it's been a lot of fun. I do it every other Saturday most of the time. And so, it was more statistical physics based in the initial phase. Now I'm trying to broaden it. And so Alex is probably the second person who is doing a granular talk. But the first one was Xiaoping from Paris, who okay. You know, I'm sure.
This is wonderful that we have this opportunity to discuss things despite all these commotions.
Yeah, I hope you will be able to join whenever. Alex, you are here.
I'm sorry. I was saying that it's an honor for me to participate in this seminar, but also that the pioneer in this area, Professor Nestorenko, is part of the seminar. It's a real honor. It's a true honor and pleasure.
Thank you
very much for attending.
I like very much even your abstract. Probably it's enough for me.
I know that your standards are very high, so I hope that you will not be too harsh with me with your questions.
I'm scared of Vitaly all the time. But the good thing about Vitaly is that even if he's very critical of me, normally I would get very angry with people, and my blood pressure would go up. But with him, it never goes up.
I always thought very high about you, but it does not mean that I like you every paper which you write. Sister Rajit, it's a very serious issue, because if we are, let's say, decided not to pay attention to detail in our area, then it will deteriorate very fast. And so that's why if you have some type of arguments, it's just very helpful, because it helps you and me also to, let's say, clarify things. It's a complex area. It's not too many people working in this, but it's a very promising area. Like in Alex abstract, it's evident. And I think that Alex among the first who recognize it's not just a chain of particles. It's a new wave dynamics area. So that's why it's very interesting, because if it would be just a chain of particles, so what? There's nothing interesting. But new system come up, and it opened a huge area where linear and weakly nonlinear does not work. And at the same time, it encompasses weakly and linear area. So it's very unusual and interesting thing. Of course, Gerson chain was the first one when this new phenomena were discovered, but it's much more broader. And by the way, so Rajit, your recent paper when you try to bring to build electrical analog.
Yes.
It's very interesting. So this is what is necessary to be done. And actually, Surajit was the first trying to extend it into other area, let's say electrical circuits, for example, and energy harvesting. I think that energy harvesting in this system, Surajit also was the first who published paper on this one. So you see, Surajit, I remember even everything what he, and of course, your excellent, almost exact solution.
And we improved it. We improved it a little bit. I don't know if I think you saw that paper, the one in which actually that was not a granular paper. There was a solution we introduced in an Europhysics letter paper, which was for an FPU system. But that solution also works here. So I'll send it to you. But I should tell you in all honesty that whenever, I think you are the referee and you chew me up.
You look like very alive. Why?
I find it a lot of fun because I know who is on the other side chewing me.
Yeah, I'm not hiding. By the way, when I write review, I'm not hiding my identity. You can immediately tell who is a reviewer based on my Russian accent.
Absolutely.
I had the same experience. Professor Nestorenko reviewed some of my papers, and I must say that I learned a lot from his reviews. But you see, Surajit, Professor Nesterenko comes from the big school, the Russian, I should say the Soviet Union school, where, you know, everything was so rigorous and so deep in mathematics and physics. I had the pleasure to work with scientists there like Professor Leonid Manevich, who unfortunately died, unfortunately, recently. Yes, unfortunately, he passed away some months ago. So that school is the school that they're rigorous and, you know, they demand precision and everything. So, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Vitaly's work has always been the gold standard for me. So usually, but you know, one of the greatest fun in life I have had is actually picking on Vitaly's work, because that pushes me, helps push me to another level, because I have always found his work to be very layered. He does work in a very layered way. And even if I feel he's wrong, there's something about it that's always right. So as Vitaly knows,
but you know, whoever you discuss this nonlinear acoustics, as Professor Nesterenko said, you cannot use linearized theory unless there are certain conditions, strong precompression, for example, and you cannot even use weakly nonlinear theories. And so one of my first talk in the area was at Duke University. And one in the audience said, when I presented the problem, he said, Alex, this is almost impossible. What can you do with this? What can you do? But as Professor Nesterenko showed us, and other researchers, it is possible. Actually, I completely agree with Professor Nesterenko. It's a new area.
Right.
Well, in fact, how I view it is an area of intentional use of strong nonlinearity in acoustics.
Exactly.
So we use strong nonlinearity, but because it opens ways that and results that are not available.
Yes.
Correct. For example, one of the big interesting problem, let's say problem of interfaces. What you're going to do in sonic vacuum interfaces if acoustic impedance is equal zero, right? You ruin everything, right? So then you need to start to understand what is new here. And as usual happening, a lot of applications eventually will come out by designing new materials and using, Alex, you're absolutely right, using a strong linearity as a tool. In my
presentation, Professor Nesterenko, towards the end, I have an interface. So I would be very eager to see how you react and the questions that you have, because we have the interface of a granular medium with an elastic medium, so.
Yes, right. Yeah. One has acoustic impedance, another has no acoustic impedance.
I'm missing Xiaoping, that's why I'm just waiting a minute or two. He's having trouble. He has had a server problem.
I see Stefan. This is Stefan Job in France.
Stefan, just
hi, Stefan. Stefan,
has hello, Surajit.
Hey, how's your son doing?
Fine. He's crying now.
You're not making him into a scientist yet?
Sorry?
You're not making him into a scientist yet?
No. Hi, Vitaly.
Hi, Stefan. You see, Stefan, what is interesting? You travel all around the world, but still has a French accent. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
How are you?
I'm good. Nice to see you. Yeah.
Yeah. Nice to see you too.
I always like your paper, Stefan. Sometimes I write some comments, but you always complain there are too many comments, right?
That is funny. I think we should, maybe Alex, you can just, put your screen up.
Yes, you want to share my screen?
Yeah, let's do that.
I will do that. Yes, absolutely.
And I'll introduce you. I'm still waiting for Xiaoping, but maybe he's having too many troubles. There we go. Fantastic. Oh, I love this chair.
It's not mine, of course.
I know. I have used that too, actually.
My grandson likes this tool too.
I didn't get this news.
Right. Oh, I'll have a few of them. And by the way, everybody remember Chiara, right?
Yes.
And Chiara told that her first tool was this one.
Yeah.
You need to be very careful with the tools for your kids. It can it may lead you to become a Caltech professor, you know?
Yeah, right. It's entirely possible. Okay, maybe we should get started. I don't know what trouble. Oh, sharp image. Okay, finally. I don't know why there is a echo. Not the best thing. Sec. So we are pretty much on time.
Should I mute to see if the echo?
No. We'll just all of us mute minute anyway. So
okay.
We'll let you start the show. Sharping is here. Good. Okay. So that works. So thank you everyone for making your Saturday morning a fun time with us. Talking granular, nonlinear, granular, acoustic, solitary waves, nonlinear normal modes. Our speaker today is Professor Alex Vakakis. Alex is from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And the topic is actually going to be topics on the strongly nonlinear acoustics of ordered granular media. I'll briefly introduce Alex and then we'll get going. Excuse me. So Alex received a PhD from Caltech in 1990, an MSc from Imperial College London in 1985, and a diploma in mechanical engineering from the University of Patras, Greece, 1984. He serves as the Donald Bigger Willett Professor of the College of Engineering of the University of Illinois at Urbana, where he co-directs the linear and nonlinear dynamics and vibrations laboratory. He is the recipient of an Alexander von Humboldt Research Award in 2019, the Edmund Safra Visiting Professorship at Technion in 2019, the ASME Thomas K. Cawhey Award in Nonlinear Dynamics 2014, and since 2015 acts as a national high-end foreign expert in China. He has published over 300 archival publications, holds 4 patents, and authored or edited 6 technical texts and monographs. His research interests focus on nonlinear dynamics, vibrations, and acoustics from the macro to the micro scales, granular media, and acoustic metamaterials, nonlinear system identification, non-smooth dynamics, and vibration energy harvesting. So it is a real pleasure to have Alex with us. And with that introduction, I will no longer waste your time and we'll kick it off with Alex.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Surajit. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present this talk in your great seminar series, which took us from politics, you know, the election, presentations that kept me awake at night for some days, I must say, to these very nice thermodynamics and the granular media presentations and the other nice nonlinear physics presentations. So thank you. And also thank you for giving me the opportunity to present this talk in front of esteemed colleagues. I'm really honored. So can you hear me okay?
Yeah, it's completely okay. Our
great. So Surajit, could you inform me 5 minutes before my allocated time? Because I have the bad tendency to speak a lot, okay? So that we don't want to get out of time. Thank you. So I just want to say that this research was funded in part by Army Research Office Multidisciplinary Grant, MURI Grant, which has now ended. And let's start by a definition that I like about the granular material, which is an ensemble of discrete solid macroscopic particles.
Alex,
yes,
I can't see your screen.
You cannot see my screen?
Yeah, I don't know why. Is that a problem at my end only?
No, I can see it.
Okay, then it's a problem at mine.
Okay. I can see it too.
Okay, great.
All right. So it might be, did you solve the problem, Surajit?
No, we are fine. Something happened on my end. I fixed it.
Okay. Thank you. So as I was saying, granular material is an ensemble of discrete solid macroscopic particles that have dissipation, and these particles interact. A common example is when grains collide between themselves. They form a granular material that typically it should be large enough so that they are not subject to thermal fluctuations. So size limits range from micrometers to meters, like colliding icebergs, for example. This area, and we were discussing with Professor Nestorenko, who's attending the seminar, he's one of the pioneers, is the pioneer, actually, in this area of ordered granular media. They are a fantastic acoustic medium that it's strongly nonlinear. And to give an indication that as this example, this experiment by Bagnoli and Guarino show, they can exhibit, granular media can exhibit all three forms of matter. So they what they did is, I don't know if you, probably you can see my video here. So what they did is they took a table, a vibrating table with a shaker here. With a shaker here. And so they apply a shaker, they incline the table at an angle. And so they forced at a frequency of 20 hertz, and they start increasing gradually the amplitude. So you see, this is the solid stage. Of the medium. If they increase the amplitude a little bit, it's a long video, they go to this, you see you have these fluid layers here. So the medium performs like a fluid, right? And so they have this these layers of fluidification, and then increasing more the amplitude, you know, the fluid layers increase and even more increase until for very large amplitudes, they become like a gas. You see, they become like a gas. So depending on the energy, actually, depending on the energy, the dynamics, the acoustics, and the dynamics, if you want, of this media can range from, can get all three forms of matter. This to me is a very fascinating demonstration of the great, avenues that this media presents. Now, in my view, there are two major areas of research. One is granular flows, and the other is ordered granular media. So we're not working on granular flows. That means, granular media with no symmetries in the way that they are formed. Rather, we consider assemblies of granular media where they say we have some sort of symmetry. I believe this was done in the lab of Professor Darayo in Caltech. This also three-dimensional, two-dimensional, one-dimensional, I'll discuss more about this, where you have granular media embedded in elastic matrix. So what we wish to do is want to study the fascinating properties of this media. And of course, for most of us, we were, I will come to that, we're motivated by the work of Professor Nestorenko. But when we model an ordered granular medium, we have to operate under certain assumptions. So if you have two granules or beads interacting in Hertzian contact, then the, first of all, you have to assume that the contacting surface is smooth, continuous and frictionless. The granules contact at a point or line under no load condition and over a surface area upon the application of loads. The size of the contact area is small in comparison to the size of the solid body, and strains are within the elastic limit. That's an important assumption. Stress in the immediate neighborhood of the contact is much higher than in the bulk of the material. And this is very important. The dynamics of the waves propagating inside the bulk of the material It's much faster than the dynamics of the acoustics that you observe in the medium per se. So under these conditions, a set, let's say the simple set of ordered granular medias, this where bits interacting with each other, you can simulate them by, you can simulate them by a spring mass system, but with very peculiar springs. See these springs that they look here like normal springs, they're not. So for spherical particles, the interaction law, you see it here. So if you assume that there's no precompression in this line of bits that I showed you before, when they are in contact, they approximately interact. This is force versus relative displacement between the centers of the bits. They interact approximately according to the Hertzian law, which is delta to the 3/2. However, in the absence of compression, they nothing is there to keep them separate, to keep in contact. So they separate. And so this is zero. I mean, the interaction is zero. Now, so for someone who looks at least law, at least from my experience, one would say, okay, so I have a problem, as Professor Nesterenko called it, it's a sonic vacuum, because the linearized speed of sound, as you define it in classical acoustics, is zero, because the slope here is zero, okay, is zero. So, but that's a problem that we, okay, it's a difficult problem, but it's not so difficult for us, because we have done a lot of work on vibrations of systems with essential nonlinearities, that is nonlinearities that have zero slope, that have no linear components. The real killer here, the real problem is this, in my view, which is that in the absence of compression, you don't have a system, right? I mean, you have a line of bits, but if you don't have any compression, any local compression, the bits can separate. And so that's a formidable problem. Even if you can solve this effect here, the fact that they separate in the absence of compression, then that poses a new kind of dynamical acoustical systems, which are highly discontinuous, right? Now you can do many things. You can put precompression. If you put precompression, then you remove this singularity here, and so you prevent the system from separating that easily. But then you pay for that because you lose some of the acoustics. So a linear component of the acoustics appears, and so the more precompression you put, the more linear the acoustics become, and so you get another kind of problem. So if you consider, let's keep with this one-dimensional granular lattice, and I'm using this notation here, this plus here, subscript means that two bits interact in Hertzian contact, but only when delta is greater than zero. When delta is less than zero, they can separate. So it's deceivingly simple the way we wrote it here. But anyways, you can write the equation of motion. You can do a long wavelength approximation. If you assume that you have no separation, that's an important point, right? Because you need to have a system, a system in contact to do that. So you can go from a discrete set of variables to continuous. You can use, you can introduce derivatives. At the end of the day, however, you get to the leading order, you get an equation like this, which describes the variation, the acceleration actually, in terms of these derivatives with respect to x. And you see that if you compare it with the classical equation, this whole term here basically substitutes for c squared. So the effective speed of sound basically depends on the slope, on the state of the system, okay? And so you don't, in other words, you do not have a constant term that basically would make this a perturbation of the classical wave equation. And so this represents indeed a new class of acoustics that where the linear acoustics go out of the window, you have nowhere to get help from. You cannot get help from linearization. You cannot get help from weakly nonlinear methods like averaging or multiple scales. And some people would think that this is hopeless. But actually it's not, because It turns out that you can do some analysis. So you can take the strongly nonlinear acoustics of the system, the sonic vacuum, and discover a new kind of phenomenon. So actually my presentation is titled Topics on Ordered Granular Media, because really it's this area is so vast that I could not give any sort of complete presentation. But I just want to share with you some of the possibilities that our group has found and taken. And we think that this represents an extremely promising new area of dynamics and acoustics, because it gives unprecedented opportunities for new phenomena and that we can harvest. Just to give you an idea, if you have some cylinders in contact, it turns out that the contact law is linear. And if you apply, let's say, an impulse here, you generate a pulse, but this pulse has some sort of dispersion as it propagates. But if you take spherical beats, one together, one equal with the other, then as Professor Nesterenko showed in his pioneering work, you get the solitary wave that propagates with no dispersion. This is the so-called Nesterenko solitary wave, okay? Now, let's see, and of course he found the famous cosine to the fourth solution, which although is an approximate solution, because no exact solution to my recollection has been found for this problem. Actually, I don't know even if it exists. So, but we can discuss this another time. So what makes this work is basically the long wavelength approximation is the fact that this is an animation of the Nesterenko solitary wave. You see that it involves pure momentum exchange between beats. But if you observe, there's never separation between beats, okay? It's a very special form of solution where a beat interacts with the next beat, but at the end of the day, it just stays in contact. So there's no separation. So that allows for a long wavelength approximation. So when I saw this pioneering work and this nice phenomenon, I asked myself, are there any other additional intrinsic dynamics? Can a periodic sonic vacuum support acoustic filtering? For example, can it have pass bands and stop bands? Can they support traveling or standing waves? And also, if they can support such waves, how is the inherent dynamics related to forced responses like resonances? I won't talk today about the resonances, but we have explored this phenomenon. Also, what new types of nonlinear phenomena can arise due to the essential and non-smooth nature of the nonlinearities? Okay. Now, this question, I'm afraid that has not been answered, and because people discover more and more and more new properties and fascinating applications. So in our view, in order to address such questions, we need to follow a systematic study, which would start us from the simple and hopefully will get us to the more complex, okay? So just to give you a prelude, and I don't have time to go through this, it turns out that the Nesterenko solitary wave is an accumulation of a countable infinity of families of strongly nonlinear traveling waves that are supported by the homogeneous infinite granular chain. And we have published this paper to show that. I won't lose any time on this, but you can impose conditions of periodicity every n bits, and you can formulate the reduced order models, and then you can integrate these reduced order models and study the asymptotic behavior as n goes to infinity. So first result is that yes, in addition to the Nesterenko solitary wave, we have a countable infinity of strongly nonlinear waves. However, it's not very easy to excite because they need special initial conditions. However, they are there. Then what about what we call nonlinear normal modes? What about standing waves, okay? Our experience with vibrations is that in finite granular media, this can influence a lot the dynamics. So indeed, if you take a simple system, again, we have to start from the simple of three beats. You have different modes like in-phase modes and out-of-phase modes. This is an in-phase mode that you see here. So you have boundaries. So it looks like a traveling wave here. because it's like a wave that propagates through the chain, of bits, and then coming back. But this, trust me, this is not a traveling wave. This is what we call the in-phase nonlinear normal mode. And this plays a very important role, as we will discuss, in terms of the bonding of the systems. Why? Because, again, and I have to compress these results, but if anyone is interested, I'll be very happy to provide the publications that support this. So if you look at the frequency energy plots, so this denotes the energy that you induce to the system, and we're talking about actually the energy density, whatever you want to call it, of a finite system of bits. And this is the frequency of the standing wave. This in-phase modes, and I looked at 2 bits, 3 bits, 4 bits, up to 7 bits. So all the in-phase modes that I showed you before, let's say for 2 bits, 3 bits, accumulate into a curve, okay, this I stop it at 7, which provides a lower band of a region. All the out-of-phase and nonlinear modes, and this is, I guess, is easy to visualize. So basically these are motions where adjacent bits oscillate anti-phase with respect to each other. And when you do not have enough number of bits, you just set equal to zero some of this, some of these motions. In any case, they accumulate to out-of-phase nonlinear modes. It turns out the standing waves in a system of arbitrary number of bits can occur only in a particular zone. And this we call the propagation zone. This is nothing more than a nonlinear passband for this periodic system. This is a periodic system, so you expect to have a passband because of the periodicity. Only the boundaries, of course, depend on energy. It's not like in linear systems. So this affects very much. So this affects very much the dynamics of the system. So to give an example, if you take 50 bits and you apply a harmonic excitation of frequency omega and amplitude A and you fix this boundary, again, we're talking about one-dimensional simple cases. You have the propagation zone. By the way, this out-of-phase modes accumulate to the zero line, which we suspect that it might be the Nesterenko solitary wave here. So what you can do is you can do some numerical simulation or you can do experiments where you start, let's say, the system at this state where you have the energy, the total energy that you induce at steady state is about here and the frequency is here. And then you can move sideways by reducing the energy until you reach the attenuation zone. Let's see what happens then. So this is a case of a propagation zone. This is a case of excitation in the propagation zone. And this shows the displacement of certain bits. And you see that these are spatially extended. Here is a snapshot of the displacements of the entire chain. So we took the instantaneous displacements at certain instance of time. And this is interesting. This is the mean energy level of the system in time. So you reach, you see that after some time, you reach this level of a non-zero, large non-zero mean energy. So that's happening when you have motion in the propagation zone. Here's an animation, right? Here's the animation of the result with 5 bits, of course. So you are moving the left boundary with a relatively small frequency, and you're generating solutions that propagate throughout the system. This is in the passband. Okay. So then the obvious question is, what happens when you are in the stop band? Well, you are in your stop band, you get localization of energy, right? So again, the same, these are displacements of some bits. Here, it turns out that you have so much precompression that the system becomes almost linear, right? Again, the same system at different energy levels, at different frequencies, changes itself. There's a metamorphosis from strongly nonlinear, where you have separation between beats, the word you saw before, in the pass bands, to what? To weakly nonlinear. In fact, almost linear. And this is exactly the case like that. So the system behaves like a linear system. So the tunability of these systems to energy and frequency is quite amazing. You don't have to do anything in the structure of the system. Just change the energy and the frequency, the system will change its dynamics, its acoustics on itself. That's what we call passively adaptive to energy and to frequency. So if you see the instantaneous displacements, you see that for long times you get this this decay that's a characteristic of linear motion in stop bands. And if you see the energy versus time, you see that after some time, the energy gets a very low level. And so what happens in this case? You see that the frequency is so high now that it puts the system into kind of a permanent state of precompression. And the more precompression you put, then the more linear the acoustics become. Okay, so that's a first indication that we got that, hey, this tunability of this kind of systems, which it's because they are sonic vacuum. It's because their effective speed of sound depends on the energy and the frequency. This enables us to get this kind of tunability that is not simply not possible in other systems with linear components. So we decided to be serious, to get serious with this system. So we built an experiment. Basically what you see is the little experiment we built, nothing very fancy, but we got results that surprised us. So what we did is we worked with material scientists and Trudy Kriven actually at UIUC, and we embedded a system of steel beats into matrices, okay? And different kind of matrices. So we have a shaker, there is the stinger of the shaker goes through this guide to get unidirectionality. We put a force transducer here, so you see the force transducer here so that we know what we excite. And this is the stinger. And so this excites one end of this beat system. And at the other end, we have another force transducer to measure the response, okay? Simple experiment to see how this system behaves. And this is a metamaterial now, right? Because this, I mean, on the outside, you see a block of material that has inside it a structure. This a highly discrete structure. So we consider this configuration, which is the schematic. We put a harmonic excitation here. And so the red bit is where we measure the force that this exerts on the force transducer. But we also consider this this alternative system, where we took now two lattices, if you want, two chains. Again, it's a metamaterial. The green is I'm not sure if you can see it, but these are embedded into a material matrix. And now we apply the excitation in what we call the excited chain. And we use a laser vibrometer to measure the response at the red bit here. And the other chain, which we call the absorbing chain, we have it in contact with the force transducer so we can measure the force. And now this material, you know, presumably, will introduce some energy transfer between the two. And so we wanted to know if you excite one of the chains, what kind of dynamics, what kind of acoustics can it excite on the other chain? So yes, we, moreover, for this system here, we use different gaps to, because presumably this would affect the strength of the coupling. 0.5 millimeters between them, 1.5 millimeters and 2.5 millimeters. And also we used three different material matrices, PDMS, polyurethane, and geopolymer, which is a very stiff, it's like a rock, a very stiff embedded materials. So we created samples of this system, so both of the systems for all these alternative cases. Here's an example, it's an experiment. This is the input as we measured. This is the velocity of the armature head at this point here, and this is the force transducer. This is the input, it's a harmonic input at 100 hertz. And what we see here is a traveling wave. Is a traveling wave that we send through the chain, and you see here that these discontinuities that you see, which are repeated in everyone, is because of ground interactions. Okay, so you have a loading phase and then a relaxation phase. This little bump here is very important because this signifies the effect of the foundation. In other words, the elastic matrix and the boundary condition is Teflon here, right? So we have Teflon left and right, acts as an elastic substrate. And so this here represents the effect of the substrate, okay? And so that's very nice. At low frequencies, we get this traveling wave here. We're in a passband, right? This is the transmitted force in the transducer. Again, is the red bit. And this is the on-site potential that we get. And you know, we can just measure the acoustics that we get is strongly nonlinear and non-smooth. You have separation of bits, you have spatial transfer of energy within the granular medium, you have a passband. Now let's look at the same frequency, but now on this system. So again, now we start having interference effects, and we are fully aware that that this will not be a perfect harmonic excitation, but that's the best we can do. And so what you see here is the laser measurement of the end response of the red bit, and you see the full wave that arrives, okay? And you see at steady state, you get this wave. Again, you have the discreteness effects because of ground interactions. And then you have the force transducer, the force here, and you see only half of the action because once the blue granule separates, then the force transducer cannot measure, right? So we could not put a laser here. So unfortunately we got only half the pulse here. But you see that even though you excite with a harmonic excitation, this chain, the excited chain, you do get energy transferred to the absorbing chain, okay? So again, the bit responses are strongly nonlinear and non-smooth. We have spatial extended responses, and this is a passband for this system. Again, we have the effects of the on-site potentials and we have the ground interaction. So it's like having two chains with on-site potentials and coupling potential. Now, what happens again at this frequency when you change the material? Okay, when PDMS, polyurethane, geopolymer, you see pretty much the same phenomena, but of course, as you move from left to right, especially geopolymer is very stiff material. Okay, so this will affect the transfer. You have stronger coupling, you have more energy transferred, but what you see is that basically the acoustics that we observe in one of these materials we observe for the others, which is very encouraging about the robustness of this phenomenon. So the stiffer the matrix is, the higher is the energy transfer. But then we increase the frequency, and I still remember that day, we got a result that was truly provocative. So what we expected to see is when you increase the frequency a lot, we would see what we saw before. We see linearization and almost linear acoustics. Instead, there is an intermediate region where you have breathers, right? And these are experimentally observed breathers in this material, which is a very fascinating to us result. So basically what you see here is PDMS, the single chain, where you apply a harmonic excitation at 400 hertz, and you see the characteristic of the slowly varying envelope with the fast oscillation inside. So you form propagating breathers due to the classical modulation instability. And so you have breathers that propagate and reflect it, and you capture that. If you go to 500 hertz, you get a different breather, which is even more interesting. So you get this kind of breather, this wave packets. Again, this PDMS, but at 500 hertz, where you have this wave packet that moves back and forward, and in between you have no response. It's a very clear wave packet that propagates. So if you go to 700 hertz, the wave packet is still there, still there. And as you increase the frequency, what you expect is that this wave packet would disappear and you would get what you would expect at very high frequencies, linearized acoustics and a stop band. So, but what about now this system here? Do we see breathers here? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. So if we apply this harmonic excitation here at 500 hertz, again, these are very robust phenomena, extremely robust phenomena. We're fascinated by how robust this phenomenon is. And as I will show, it's across material matrix, right? So it's not just for PDMS. So here you see the full breather propagating through the chain. Here you see half the breather, as I said. You transmit, there's a breather exchange, there's a breather exchange between the two. And you know, this breather is recorded here, but only half, because once this thing separates, yes, then you lose the force. So yes, indeed, for this system here, you have energy exchange, but now in the form of propagating breathers. And now if you take this breather here and you do the Fourier transform, you'll see the classical indication of the breather, where you have the excitation frequency, you have the side bands, right? Which is due to the modulation instability. So indeed, this is a breather that we see here. What happens if we change material? Well, the breather is still there. You see, the breather is still there. It's a 500 hertz. So it appears, amazingly enough, for all these materials. Is it the same breather? No, it's not, because the material properties will affect the coupling and the on-site potential, but they're still there. And so we had the following idea. How would this breather sound if we map them in pressure acoustics? So how this series of propagating breathers would sound if we took the waveforms and we map them into the acoustic regime? So what you're gonna hear here is the material speaking, if you want, is the material under harmonic excitation and how the material would speak to you through the breather. So this is PDMS. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
Okay, great. All right. Now, what about in polyurethane? Different sound, slower. And what about now in a geopolymer? Different sound. So you know, the opportunities that this opens is basically relating the strongly nonlinear acoustics to pressure acoustics, okay? For example, if you want two metamaterial systems, again, this is futuristic, but I'm allowed to dream, right? So we can see a situation, I can envision a situation where materials, metamaterials can communicate with each other. How? Well, taking for example, the waves that are generated from one, feed them to a speaker, and then have a receiver in the other material, and then somehow use that either as an excitation or whatever, or speaking to you. What about if they could speak to you, right? If you could form, let's say, by using different chains and different materials, what about if you could make them utter even simple words? Again, I'm dreaming, but no one prevents me from dreaming, okay?
Alex, this is very fascinating, but
you may look
probably how temperature of this material affect the response, and then you can use the system to check the health of material itself.
Exactly. Please feel free anyone to interrupt, please. And especially you, Professor Mistrenko. So this is true. And this is another application we have in mind for health monitoring, right? I mean, if you establish what is the normal, in some sense, operation of the acoustics, then you can sense abnormalities. Yeah. Absolutely. Again, this is just food for thought that I wanted to present. Now, what happens if you really increase the frequency to 500 hertz, to 5,000 hertz? Well, that's what we'd expect. Then the system is in a stop band. And now, you know, of course, you don't have to get a harmonic input. It's impossible due to the feedback with the system. But what you transmit is really low. Basically, you do not transmit much. So again, it's a fascinating property of this metamaterial system that you move at low frequencies for strongly nonlinear traveling waves, intermediate frequencies to breathers, and then high frequencies to linearized stop bands, right? So, okay, so I don't want to spend any lot of time here. If you do the FFT, you will see that you have the excitation frequency here. And this is for all three matrices that we showed is common. So basically they all behave like this. So this is very robust. So this concludes one of the topics. Let's move to another one that we were very interested in, which has to do with using the strong nonlinear acoustics for targeted energy transfer by implementing a macroscopic analog of the Landau-Zener quantum tuning effect. That is in quantum mechanics, of course. And basically, this is work with the late professor Leonid Manevich in Moscow. And what we did is we created a model. And by the way, the experimental systems that they presented before were all studied theoretically using models like this. And it turns out that if you use models like this, you can approximate very well all the phenomena that you see there. Okay, so basically, these simple reduced order models are not just non-realistic; they are very practical. So we have again an excited chain and an absorbing chain. What we do is we have a uniform grounding stiffness distribution here, so all the indices have the same grounding stiffness. But then in the excited chain, what we do is we stratify. We gradually reduce the stiffness. We start from a stiffness that is equal to this stiffness here, right? So we start with a large stiffness, and then we relax it at the next beat and so on. And we relax it, let's say, for 1, 2, 3 beats. And then the rest of the beats have the softer background, the softer level. So what you can do by that, and again, this is a 22 percentage of spatial variation of the elastic substrate here. This is uniform, but in the excited chain is substrated. And what you can do is you can show theoretically, rigorously, that you have energy transferred from the excited chain to the absorbing chain. So this is simulation of impulse excitation, where we excite one chain, which we excite the red chain, right? And then we see that energy gets transferred to the absorbing chain. How? Well, initially you have one-to-one resonance. Initially you have one-to-one resonance between the leading beats, okay? And this is weak coupling, I must say. This is weak coupling. So you transfer energy through a beat phenomenon, a linear beat phenomenon actually, because this is linear coupling, from the excited leading beat to the absorbing leading beat. But then this energy cannot come back because you break the symmetry. You see, by breaking the symmetry here, this energy is trapped, if you want, is trapped into the absorbing chain and cannot come back. It's pretty much like what the Landau-Zener tuning effect is doing. So for this, you don't have to use the nonlinearity, actually. You could use a linear system. However, using the nonlinearity, you achieve two things. Number one, you can initiate breathers here. And number two, your acoustics is tunable with energy and frequency. And you can, of course, you cannot do that in linear theory. Recently, we experimentally verified this effect, to our knowledge, for the first time, not with granular media, but with lattices. Okay, and this will appear in a special issue of the Journal of Applied Physics, where you have the theoretical model and the experimental verification, this is on the special issue on metamaterials, on acoustic metamaterials. Anyways, so what you have is that energy that you induced is the total energy in the excited and the absorbing chains. You induce energy in the excited chain, this energy gets transferred in time to the absorbing chain, not completely, but a major portion of it. And if you do this diagram here, which is the space-time diagram here is, I used 50 bits. This is the number of bits, the bit index. Here is the time. And what you see here is the average, is the actually instantaneous total energy that each bit has. You see you excite the excited chain and immediately you launch a pulse in the absorbing chain. Actually, it turns out to be a breather. Okay, so this is energy redirection, is irreversible energy transfer that you can achieve. You don't have to be in the beginning. You can do this asymmetry, you can introduce this asymmetry towards the middle of the chain, whatever you want. And so in this regime here, until you reach bit 20, 27, you have breather exchange. And after you reach that bit, then you have irreversible energy transfer. So you see this bit exchange here before you reach the asymmetry, and then immediately you channel energy here. So to us is another very interesting phenomenon that you get. And actually we use, it's a very interesting application of a quantum effect to metamaterials. So that, of course, the quantum effect is in time. Okay, the tunneling between molecules was studied in time, but here we do it in space. The asymmetry is space. And also you can do multiple chains. For example, these are three chains. Okay, first you introduce an asymmetry between the first two chains, and then you transfer the energy from the first to the second. The third chain is not activated yet, but when you introduce the asymmetry, then you move that energy to the third chain. And so you can have networks, two-dimensional networks or three-dimensional networks, again, look into the future of media where you can introduce predictive energy redirection. Finally, and I will conclude, I don't know how much time do I have, but this-
You have easily about 10 minutes.
Oh, fantastic. I'm proud of myself because I always overreach my time. So yeah, that's great.
You're doing great.
Thank you. That's some of the latest work that we're doing in our lab. And we were always very interested in practical implementations of granular media, especially granular mitigators. So to solve that problem, you have to account for granular media for interfaces. Before the talk, Professor Nestorenko mentioned the issue of interfaces. We also believe it's a very important topic. And so in a recent paper, actually was accepted in granular matter and is impressed right now by my student, Chongang Wan. We studied this effect, but we tried to study it as realistically as possible. So we have this hexagonally placed granular medium, and then we have a thin plate. Thin, why? Because we wanted to impose a two-dimensional plane stress approximation. Now, as a first try, this is permissible. If you increase the thickness, of course, you have to go to 3D, but we don't see any particular problems with that. Of course, it's messier. Okay, so we take into account granular viscoelastic interactions because of the internal granular dissipation. But we also, one of the big challenges is the flexible boundary. So how can you account for a flexible interface here? This is not trivial, it's by no means trivial. And also we wanted to account for frictional effects between the granules themselves, okay? Now, if you try to solve this system using the Coulomb dry friction rule, it will diverge. There's actually, the code is unstable, okay? Because of the asymmetry, of the discontinuity. So you have to be creative. At the same time, you have to take into account that convergence studies are needed, at least to show that numerically, your modeling is valid. And that's what we did. So what we did is we modeled, we had two different types of modeling interactions, of ground interactions that we had taken into account. First interaction would be between a granule and the elastic medium. That's a linear elastic medium, so it could be modeled by a finite element. And then we had to account for granular to granular interaction that concerns, these are the unit vectors that we saw here, and these are the forces, the normal forces, you know, the Hertzian forces and friction forces, okay? Similarly here, there are friction forces and there are normal forces. That's the system that we wanted to study. Now, the friction model. The friction model from previous works, we liked the TAN-H friction model, as it's called, which basically approximates, it's a smooth approximation to the Coulomb law. And actually, as Ks increases to very large values, as the argument increases to very large values, then this approximates the Coulomb law. Now, Nij is the normal force, hyperbolic tangent. Ks is this parameter of the model, and this is the relative velocity, tangential velocity between any two granules or granules with interface. This was a logistical nightmare to put together, but I have to give credits to my student Chong'an for really, really doing a fantastic piece of work. So the system, the actual system that we considered as a first demonstration is a distributed impulse excitation. It doesn't have to be distributed, but to make things simpler, we decided to use distributed. Now we have worked on localized impulse excitations. And then we have clamped boundaries left on the top and the bottom. And they don't have to be clamped. They can be also flexible, but we decided not to introduce any more complexity. This is the true flexible interface here, okay? So everything else that you see hatched here is clamped. And this is a free boundary, okay? So we have two types of systems. It's a discrete continuum system. And key to this problem, if you want to solve it, is to get converged values for the displacements and the forces at the interface. This is the true, the central point. And our codes just addressed this point, and you will see that this was not trivial. For our application, we used steel for both media. And you see here the plate thickness was 5 millimeters. Granular radius was 10 millimeters. These are the lateral dimensions, material density, and the elastic modulus. So here's the first approximation that we did, because otherwise it would be a non-well-posed problem. So what we decided to do is we introduce small rigid layers, and these basically are non-deformable rigid layers, very stiff, so that they could transmit the forces and the tractions from and the displacements from the bead to the plate. Okay, is this realistic? One might say, if you have the system design, you can certainly introduce these small additives here. In any case, without this, we would not be able to solve the problem, because then we could not apply the Hertzian law on our beats. Then we used finite element for the plate. And you see in this particular example, you have 5 contact points from beats 1 to 5. Now, I'm not going to take you through the code, but here's how we solve the problem. Remember, we have an applied excitation. So at a given time instant, the first order approximation, let's say at 0 time instant, when you start the problem, you discretize time, of course, and then you apply the impulsive load. What you do is you do an iterative process. So you assume that you have rigid boundary, and you compute the forces that are applied here, okay? And basically, this is your leading order approximation for the interaction force at that time instant. In the next step, or the iteration, at the same time instant, is now you use the applied forces that you computed to find the deformation of the plate. Okay, so the plate under these forces will be deformed. Okay, then you go back, and again at the same time instant, you apply the force again, but now you relax the condition here and you move the boundary by the amount that you computed before due to the formation of the plate. And you compute the new forces. And then you apply these forces to the plate, you got the new deformation, and then you iterate at that time instant until you get convergence of the applied forces and of the deformations at the boundary. And after you get convergence there, basically move to the next time step and you start again using, however, the state that you computed in the first time step. Now, this is in principle, but many numerical difficulties exist there. It turns out, and I'm cutting a long story short here, that the code has a numerical convergence problem. And in fact, it boils down to get a numerical convergence of this nonlinear map, which basically maps the normal and frictional forces at the jth iteration, at the time instant s plus one, to the j plus one iteration at the time instant s plus one. Again, is this iteration that was discussing before keeping fixed the time instant? This is a nonlinear map, okay? And this nonlinear map, you can create one nonlinear map for each one of these 5 points. And this index k indicates which one of the 5 contact points you are. It turns out that if you linearize map, because this can be linearized under certain conditions, you get 2 linearized eigenvalues for this map for each contact point, a two-dimensional map. The first eigenvalue, you have no problem. It's always stable. It's below one, which is basically, it has to do with the normal force. And I'm sorry, I'm using all kinds of coefficients here that I won't discuss, but because I don't have time, but again, for those who are interested, I basically refer to the paper. And it just suffice to say that the first eigenvalue give us no problems because it has to do with the Hodgian, with the Hodgian interaction. The second one now is the friction. It has to do with the friction. And it turns out that if you do not control the time step, then this eigenvalue can really become unstable. And so if you try to apply the friction, the Coulomb friction law, this eigenvalue will always be unstable, okay? So you have to strike a very good balance involving the discretization you do or the mass and the stiffness matrices for the plates, and also these coefficients for the Tanage law. And also for some other parameters, the coefficient of friction, et cetera. The big picture is that if you use a constant time step, you get instability. So what I'm doing here is here I'm plotting the total energy for the plate, which is the blue line. And this is the total energy of the discrete medium as we apply the force excitation. And at this time instant, there's an end of the simulation with fixed time step because of instability. And what happens? Well, the eigenvalue, the second eigenvalue, I said the first one is okay, is non-problematic. But the second and the third, they're the same because of symmetry. It's not because of symmetry, but it so happens that they're the same. They reach the value of one and they exceed one. And the moment they exceed one, then the iteration is non-convergent. So what we did is we used an adaptive time step, and using the adaptive time step, we follow this eigenvalue and we adjust the time step. So when it tries to go unstable, it basically reverts back below the instability region, okay? And so you see here again, this is the same simulation, but now you achieve the total stable simulation of the whole process. And you follow the eigenvalues here. The first one at k equals one is very stable. And then at 2 and 3, you see they try to reach the instability region by changing the time step you make them stable. So what we see here is we see the exchange between the energy of the ground run medium to the plate. And the total energy, of course, is the total energy without dissipation decreases when you add the dissipation as a check of the accuracy of our code is uniform. So yes, by doing that, these are the last results I'm going to show. These are some snapshots. I could show you animations, but I won't do it here. Some snapshots where we just apply the impulsive force here, and you see the wave appearing at the interface. It reaches the boundary and comes back, and then you get this situation here. An interesting thing would be to compare, and I know it's not a fair comparison, and people might have objections to that, but just for the fun of it, what would happen if I replaced the granular medium with the left plate, right? So if you do that, then you would have this very fast continuum energy exchange between what we call the left plate, the left component, and the right plate. Whereas in this case, you see that the acoustics are slowed, are significantly slowed. Actually, the time scale here is much slower than the time scale here. And instead of having these repeated energy exchanges between the two portions of the plate, you just have one big energy exchange. And you know, we might have another one, but at a later time, at a much smaller energy level. And so actually what you do, if you have the granular medium, this is what you transmit in terms of energy to the plate. But if you have the homogeneous plates, and again, I'm not claiming this is a fair comparison, but just for the fun of it, you have a front, you have a wave front, right? As expected, probably in here. Well, here you break that wave front. Okay, so the granular, that's a great power of the granular medium that is able to break apart and not only disperse this wavefront so that only traces of it are transmitted to the plate. No, it's not an accident that people have been using for centuries, you know, sandbags as protective devices, right? I mean, this is, but now we have an opportunity, we believe, to predictively design granular mitigators and not only. Okay, I'm not going into that because I'm running out of time.
Yeah, I think we are.
Yeah. Just let me conclude, Surajit. Okay. So we discussed a new class of strongly nonlinear, passively adaptive acoustic metamaterials, and we consider this as a paradigm of intentional strong nonlinearity for design. So you're using intentionally the strong nonlinearity to introduce these nonlinear acoustics, and you can get new design opportunities. These are sonic vacua. Generated by essentially nonlinear waves. It's a very promising research field in applied mathematics and physics and engineering, of course, right? And engineering. Now, depending on the local deformation of these metamaterials, you can have strongly or weakly nonlinear behavior, smooth or non-smooth dynamics. So it's a very adaptive system. You have capacity for targeted gene transfer and stress wave tailoring. What I did not discuss is the new types of nonlinear resonances that you can get. Of course, you can get nonlinear stop and pass bands that depend on energy and frequency. And of course, you can have acoustic filtering. You can get predictive designs for passive and vibration mitigation or other applications. You can apply it in metamaterial designs. You can embed this strongly nonlinear discrete media to metamaterial designs in layered media. And you know, a topic that I believe that has a lot of potential is the topic of granular containers, with flexible boundaries. So right now, the research on granular containers assumes typically fixed boundaries, right? What if, and especially the openings, right? What if, however, you could make this flexible, okay? So that you account for the local flexibility. How would the dynamics of these containers? I will end with this slide with my collaborators, Yuli Starosvetsky, a postdoc at UIUC and now faculty at Technion, was central to this research. My long-term collaborators, Larry Bergman and Michael McFarland, contributed. My PhD student, K.R. Jayaprakash, he's now faculty at IIT Gandhinagar, and Arif Hassan, another PhD student now, is faculty member at Wayne State University. Yijin Zhang, at Ford Development Center, Sam Taufik, another faculty colleague. Chong An is doing his PhD with me right now, and Sam Taufik, of course. We're co-advising him. And Ali Kanj also contributed, another jointly advised. And colleagues like Kriven, Gelderman at Technion, Leonid Manevich, the late Leonid Manevich, Chiara Darayo in Caltech, and the other people who participated also in the Muri grant. I'm grateful for the collaboration. And that's the end. And thank you very much for your attention.
Oh, thank you. This is fantastic. Yeah, please unmute yourself and feel free to applause. And we can go to questions. I actually have a question, rather a comment. And what you are calling this breeder system is actually very close to something we did in 2009 through 11. And we call this the problem of granular breeding. I actually sent you two papers. We didn't do a lot of work on it, but we wrote, most of it we didn't write up because unlike you at the time, didn't quite realize what would be the best systems to realize what we were seeing. But the work that you guys have done is really exciting because the ability to use that work to hear a material is incredibly exciting. And we discussed the fact that it can be used as fingerprint materials, but we couldn't quite get to the fact that you can do it in the way you have done it, which I think is beyond phenomenal. At least that's my feeling. So I just wanted to—
Thank you for your kind words. Thank you. Oh, yeah. We are very happy also. And we believe that the opportunities are there.
Yeah, it's really cool stuff. Okay, we are open to questions, please.
I have a quick question, actually.
Yeah, please, Nathaniel.
For the breathers that you saw in the chains, how does the frequency change if you change the length of the chain? Did you look at that or?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Yeah. That's of course they should change, but in our experiment we did not do that. You know, these experiments are not easy to do, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So we had to be satisfied with a certain number of beats. But the mathematical models that we created to be able to interpret this phenomena can be used to answer this question. So I would be very happy, if you're interested, to send you some of our works on the modeling. And then once you have the solution, and we have actually analytical solutions for these breeders based on complexification averaging, a technique that the late Manevich introduced, and we're all students of his pioneering work. I consider myself a student of his school of thoughts in Moscow, and he used this very powerful complexification averaging method, which is basically a nonlinear extension of the multiple scales method, only you don't need to use linearized frequencies. So to answer your question, yes, this can be done, and this can be theoretically analyzed, we believe.
Okay.
I may ask a question.
Yeah, please, Vitaly.
First of all, Alex, it's absolutely fascinating talk. Thank you very much. It is really, really interesting. And I am actually amazed. Well, I will mix my comment with question if possible. Interesting that somebody asked you that it is not possible to do something with this strong nonlinear system. First of all, you demonstrated that it can be useful tools, number one. And second one, I would like to refer to a very interesting but extremely short comment, but in the letter of Albert Einstein to Max Born, when he told him that he's looking for systems with respect to his gravitational general theory of relativity, that he's looking for system which will have a dependence of speed of propagation on amplitude, which we understand it was, he was looking for strongly nonlinear system. So he did not say it, but apparently. And so I would like to say that it's very natural step to look for strong nonlinear system in the broad aspect. And I'm very amazed that somebody will question why you need to do this. But so your presentation is wonderfully demonstrated that it's very fertile area. Now about the frequency dependence of the system is very interesting, because usually we talk about tunability by force, but this tunability by frequency is totally amazing. Now, maybe I missed something, but if you introduce initial gaps between particles, then probably high frequency will effectively pre-compress the system. Is that correct?
Yes, I think we did some work in this area, Professor Nesterenko. Especially, I think it was Jagaprakash who did them, but we never published that. If you introduce gaps, we never published this, but yes, they affect the acoustics, but I don't remember how, yes, they will introduce some pre-compression, yes.
So it could be very interesting, because then you have a totally, let's say, separated grain and high frequency effectively pre-compresses them. And this is very, very interesting. And what I would like to mention also that linearity, you don't need necessarily Hertzian interaction. You actually don't need even power law interaction. This non-linearity will appear almost for any strong non-linear interaction law. So Gerson system is a nice thing because you can easily do experiment, but you can design system with very complex interaction law, like tensegrity systems. Tensegrity system can be tuned from normal behavior to abnormal behavior by precompression. So it is a more, let's say, general case, which can be extended to, for example, to tensegrity material. And also I would like to say that all area, when I started to do research in this area, was very practically oriented. It is, you mentioned sandbags, but sandbags are not the best way to absorb a very high amplitude of impact, because you create a lot of dust. That's how people arrive to the granular bed from metal drops, because they don't create dust. And it was experimentally found that contact explosion on the granular bed is probably the best way, the granular bed is the best way to mitigate contact explosion. And this was implemented in a very, let's say, important experimental design when you can mitigate high amplitude loads. Is it what you are trying to go in this area in the last part of your talk, when you look in the contact of the plate and short a small number of beads and granular material? This can be very important device to mitigate impact loads. And for example, for some small devices like cellular phones or something, you have a very important problem to mitigate impact. And this direction is very important from a practical point of view, because now you can optimize granular mitigating layer, let's say, to create the minimum mass of granular materials and the most optimal material of grains, and maybe even introduce dissipating forces. But nice thing what you did that you can introduce a lot of mitigation without any dissipation, right? Mostly due to that. And this is nice thing about the strong and nonlinear systems, that they can process external excitation on very short distances. So, and this is a very important for design of novel metamaterials, because you don't want to create metamaterial which is 1 kilometer long, right? So this is strong linearity of this discrete system allows to create a very small, relatively small size of metamaterial which can process effectively impact loads.
And this is true. Excuse me for interrupting, Professor Nastarenko. This is true that it is a fast reaction time. So you get this nice nonlinear dispersion extremely fast.
Correct. Because if you have weak nonlinearity, the wave travels very long distance before they start to change. But let's say, as the first experiment was demonstrated, even, let's say, 10 bits can dramatically change impact way. And so this is one of the special place of strong nonlinear metamaterials, which allows minimization of the size of metamaterial to reach important phenomena. If Rajit will allow me to say a few more, few more words. I would like to say that exciting to see a teacher, Sonia Sam, who is present, because you know, in the school demonstration of the Newton cradle, it was very long, wrong demonstration of the conservation of energy and impulse, right? They say, well, if you have multi-body system, this multi-body system wants to act separately with each grain. In fact, they create a, let's say, self-organized phenomena. And in the classroom, you can introduce to the students, look, this is a nice example of multi-body phenomena, right? And don't believe this wrong demonstration that one particle should result in the motion of only one particle. It's itself self-organized, it seems that the five particles transmit energy and the impulse. It's not just one-to-one particle. So I think it's very interesting to tell school children that strong nonlinear systems experience self-organization. And it is wonderful example if you take a longer chain, not five, but 20, then you can say, look, it's mostly one particle moves, but then another particle, and that's why it's happening, because they have a new phenomena, something like this. So it would be wonderful demonstration and telling students that if you have many objects, you can experience self-organization. And then you can tell about society. If there are a lot of experimenting people, they can self-organize themselves in some time in a very weird phenomenon, right? And it's like a type of joke. So
yeah, no, Vitaly, you remember the sometime back with Chiara, actually, we did a paper where we tried to essentially generalize the Hertz law a little bit in FISDAV. Sunny was the one whose brainchild that work was. He was my PhD student at the time. This was about a decade ago. I don't know if you saw that, but anyway, I mean, yeah, he also worked with Fukushima after that. So yeah, he does some really interesting stuff in his school. I was actually virtually visiting his school 2 days ago in New Mexico. Oh. Yeah, so good point, good comment, thank you. Sorry, I interrupted you, go ahead.
No, I almost finished. Let me just check. I make a brief notes. Let me see. You see, also, this type of system not very inspired by granular chain. But again, I would like to emphasize that it is, for example, another example, unstretched line. You have unstretched line, right? If you attach particles to unstretched line, then transverse vibration, example of zonic vacuum, because the propagation of speed in the stretched line is T zero, initial, let's say, tension divided by rho. If T zero is equal to zero, then you have zonic vacuum, right? But it has nothing to do with granular materials, right? Another example, if you have a gas and liquid, and gas is in the temperature close to critical temperature, then compressibility is equal to zero. So this is another system which has nothing to do with the granular materials. Tensegrity system, highly tunable from abnormal behavior to normal behavior, nothing to do with the Hertzian interaction. So that's why when people emphasize too much Hertzian interaction, it's a little bit misleading for people because they say, oh, it's only about chain of particles. It's true, it came from this example. But like Kartweg de Vries way came from example in experiment with an endless channel, right? Right? And then it has nothing to do with the almost with the waves in the water. It's just shifted to the lattices, to the granular material. So I think it's necessary to look at this, how what demonstrated Alex today. This is
Professor Sterenko, just on that point, with the late Professor Manevich, we have worked on exactly that system that you mentioned. So okay. On the unstretched line, and we showed that it's a sonic vacuum, and we observed that the sonic vacuum condition came from geometric nonlinearity, but not from granular interaction. So I would be happy to send you the papers.
Yeah, wonderful, wonderful. And this is a, one of the good examples when it's interesting that in all textbook about transverse vibrations in the cables, they everybody start with T0 non-zero. At the same time, it's very interesting that everybody can get a non-stretch cable, right?
Yeah.
And so it's another area when, and by the way, wave propagation in unstretched cables can be interesting, let's say for the space exploration. When you have a lot of cables and you have a vibrations of the transverse vibration, which are in unstretched cables. And I think it's very interesting in another area. Alex, thank you very much for presentation. And thank you for long comments.
Thank you, it was my honor. And thank you for the fascinating questions and comments. Actually, now all we have to do is to convince the funding agencies to fund all these beautiful applications.
I know.
This is one of the problem. You know, I would like to say the funding agencies in the United States are the best in the world. I am not kidding. But still, they are made from ordinary people, usually who cannot make a career in academia. They become officers in the funding agencies. So they are best. They are the best, but they still, how to say, not like you, Alex. Or like
I'm not worthy of that. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a big problem. But actually, I would love a copy of that paper with Manevich also.
Absolutely. Shopping,
there you are. I finally get to see you.
I will send it to Surajit and make feel free to distribute it. And I'll send to Professor Strank also to whoever is interested.
Yeah, Shaoping, you have a question?
Yeah. I have a question. Thank you very much, Professor Vagakis, for this very nice talk. I'm very happy to hear the comments of the Professor Dennis Tarenko about this capacity to have a very small samples, just a few particles, to attenuate, to damp. This shock impact. I completely agree that this things is not necessarily related to the brand new chains. I mean, the long brand new chains. Because I'm from the granular community. When I hear, for example, your introduction at the very beginning, just to say, okay, a granular may have the different state, the gas and the fluid, which is a disorder. And in the solid, implicitly, you switch to your talk about the order of granular media. And implicitly, to suggest that this is the state of the solid. As you know, the granular solid, just like you mentioned it at the end, the center piles, or just the ballast, in the most of the case, it is the disorder granular medium. So this is what we are working, make just the mechanical test or rheologic experiments or just the sound propagation in the sense that the linear sound propagation, also you have this scattered waves as a function of the frequency because your wavelength is different. So yeah. This is a comment also. I'm very happy that Professor Nesterenko just say it's not necessary. Sometimes I have a feeling since decades, it can make some misleading. People are talking about the granular medium, the granular materials. But here what is important is just a few structures. We have a very strong nonlinear interaction. So my first question will be for you, for the people like me, working with the 2D or 3D, even 2D disordered granular medium, do you could we have this solitary like waves? So some people say, you probably know, who is Vincenzo Vitelli. Now he's working at Chicago University. When he was in Leiden University, he talking about for the shock of propagation, doing some simulation, just in the disordered 2D system. So my first question, I just want to make sure, because there are different terminology in the different places. So do you believe what he called in the simulation stuff? Because he find what he called the shock-like waves, the signature is because the short front propagation is proportional to the particle velocity. So it is completely different to the linear acoustic waves, whose velocity, as Professor Lanz-Jenko said, is depending on, as you remind, with the static compelling pressure. That's why when the medium is not compressed, the linear sound velocity will go to zero. So these things is also just mentioning that it's very important. When the confined press is zero, the granular people will say, okay, your jammed granular medium becomes a kind of liquid. It makes sense if we take into account the sheer linear acoustic waves, because people know that if you have a solid to the liquid a transition, the shear modulus will tend to zero. So sometimes people also, okay, if I have the confined pressure is tends to zero, I may obtain the linear shear acoustic waves whose velocity also tends to zero. So I just want your help to confirm us if you have a disordered 2D system, for example, 3D is another story, could the solitary mathematically demonstrated by Professor Lanz Tarenko, if mathematically we still have analytical some solutions for the disordered system. The second question, I will stop here. What is the role of the dissipation of the loss? As you mentioned in your second part of your talk, in your 2D, in a disordered medium, the friction, I mean, the dissipation from the friction is the ruler. It's not the exception. So it's very important stuff. So both these things are really related to the inherent is the disorder packing of the granular medium. Of course, the center pile use the things that decays for the damping. The difference, as Professor Nestorenko mentioned, to your system, to my understanding, that the center piles is a very large samples. So it's not so efficient. It appears not so efficient to damp properly. This is what you want to show. And in your small system, this kind of loss is very efficient. So thank you for your, for your comments.
Yeah, thank you. In my talk, Professor Gia, I made in the beginning the distinction between granular flows and not the granular media. So basically what you're referring to is granular flows, I believe. And we do not have any experience for this kind of systems with no symmetry.
I'm sorry, even with the disordered system, you may have a solid. So is the disordered a former solid? It's a glassy system.
Okay. So we do not have any experience with this asymmetric systems, but I will say, I'm not sure, I cannot answer the question if this kind of phenomena like solitary waves can transition that. What I do know, however, is that Yuli Starozvevsky at Technion, he has worked on solitary waves in two-dimensional media using some very sophisticated techniques. And actually, I don't want to advertise my book, but we have a book where he's the leading author. And in that book, he presents some of the results where solitary waves are studied in two-dimensional assemblies. And so the closest that we came to what you're describing is this system, but we never really did any work with disordered media. I would guess that strong statistics should be involved there. So, that the statistical properties of this media. So I'm not sure to answer that question. Your second question was?
It's about the friction. I mean,
yes, absolutely. Yeah,
because in a disordered system, the friction, the Grignani median is the main point.
Yes, the friction is the main difficulty in the two-dimensional simulations, okay? And this needs to be addressed. And the friction account for a kind of large portion of energy dissipated for the kind of symmetric two-dimensional medium. But so I'm not surprised by what you said, that in these two-dimensional asymmetric systems, this provide the main source. But I think that the methods that Chong'an and has developed in our group can be extended definitely to asymmetric arrangements. So I think we should be able to do simulations of this media that you mentioned. And the friction will play a very important role, but we must be very careful for numerical instabilities in the code. So we need to be very careful as we do the simulations. These are not easy, Okay. Especially when you have flexible boundaries and friction.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks very much. This is a very important point. Actually, we did some work on disordered system shaping. You may know from a long time ago, 2001, we wrote a paper for the chain case where we showed that the nonlinearity dominates disorder for the most part unless the dimensionality is much higher. So in 2D also, similar effects are there, but in 2D, one of the things that you see is that, at least what we found in the explorations we did, the solitary wave tendencies reduce a little bit because the dispersion in the sides tends to pick up depending upon the coordination. We never published too much on this because I thought I kind of lost interest in 2D very quickly for some
reason.
It's an important problem.
Yeah, I would guess in 2D system, or I hope one day you investigate the 3D, is that the friction loss becomes something very hard to avoid, because in 1D you may just look at the collision loss. Okay, it is more or less if the particle is very stuff, come a professor Vafagis shows that in the steel balls it's okay, but if you know, if in a 2D system, if you have the rigid particles, the friction is met. I would believe it is the reason.
Sharjit, there's a recent work by our colleague at University of Washington, who's working on granular media, who showed that in 2D, you need to take into account friction. Otherwise, you lose some portion of the dynamics.
I completely agree. Yeah. Actually, there is nice work by Otis from a long time ago, 80s, Otis Walton, that addressed some of these problems in great detail. But Otis was more interested in flow problems at the time. Vitaly probably would know.
I would like to add that the Professor Gia is right that disordered granular system, definitely 3D, they definitely need to include friction and dissipation. And what is Alex, from my point of view, clearly demonstrated that you can create small size discrete metamaterial when you explore mostly nonlinear behavior.
Yes.
So, and it was demonstrated that it is can be profitable and interesting. Now, transition to the 3D ordered system will be relatively simple. 3D ordered system, let's say if you arrange steel balls in three-dimensional lattice, and if wave propagates parallel to the one of the main planes, I think Chiara demonstrated that in 2D that it is about the same. But if you have significant disorder and significant difference in sizes, then it can be very different behavior. And I would like to put let's say ordered granular system to the class of metamaterial and disordered multi-sized granular system into granular size. In both cases, we have strong nonlinearity, but probably in disordered multi-granular size system, friction dissipation will be also dominate, maybe even more dominant than the nonlinearity. I don't know. But at this moment, it's better to separate them and not trying to stretch results in, let's say, in the nonlinear ordered metamaterial to the disordered granular material. So I started to work looking on disordered granular beds. And when I tried to put some science into that, I just discovered that you cannot use linear acoustics. And then I start to do simple, like all physicists, right? They start to look on simple models and it's like a column, right? He wanted to discover India, but he discovered America, right? So something like this. On small
scale. You're completely right. Thank you very much. Also, very nice.
Small scales happened in this case. But I think that the reason why I introduce a notion of sonic vacuum is just to pay attention that even disordered granular materials, which has additional nonlinearity to the contact interaction and zero, let's say, separation force, is an arrangement of grains under the loading, which adds additional nonlinearity. That we should be very careful to use a classical wave dynamics approach even to three-dimensional granular materials. Because from a classical point of view, there is no sound there. Of course, people just excite something and say, oh, we found the sound. But they don't report amplitude, right? They don't report frequency. And it turns out that it's not a classical sound, it's something else. That's why I would like to, let's say that what Alex did, they put notion on sonic vacuum just to make people aware that be careful even with three-dimensional, disordered, frictional granular material using a classical wave propagation theory. Just be careful. Maybe it can be used. Maybe not, but it's not media which experience a classical sound propagation. So this is what I just would like.
I think it's very nice to separate the ordered, very strong nonlinearity and the disorder. Very nice, thank you very much.
As long as you remember, there is something called weakly disorder.
Yeah.
I'm kidding.
I'm sorry, because it's a rare case when we have this company. Let's say if you have even relatively stronger disordered one-dimensional system, you still have a phenomena resembling one-dimensional ordered system, only attenuating due to disorder. So it means that in three-dimensional system with different particle sizes, you can have some localized wave, not exactly a solitary wave, but some type of localized wave which loses energy not only due to friction, but also due to the disorder, due to excitant modes which are left behind. So, and this is an interesting question. In three-dimensional disordered media, you have energy dissipation due to the fact that it cannot support a classical solitary wave. It also leaves some energy behind of excited grain and friction. Which one is more important?
Yes, Anderson localization of the waves in the linear regime is a very important thing. In the disordered, in the granular, it's very hard because of the frictional dissipation. So sometimes we don't know if it is attenuated, it's due to the interference effect by the disorder or is attenuation. Okay. So it is itself is very important. So I completely agree to try to separate a little bit the issues, to attack separate. Thank you. Yeah.
But you see, what interesting is how we can, actually, this is still unsolved problem. Ideally, it would be designed three-dimensional disordered system when we tune property of the particles, let's say the material and sizes and friction, right? So it would be still an unsolved problem, but it's a very important problem to mitigate a strong impact. All right, I need to stop.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. This has been
thank
a fantastic
you very much.
Session. Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Vitaly. Thank you, Xiaoping. Thank you, Louis, Nathaniel, everybody who has joined us, Mukesh, John, Krishnamohan. It's been a real delight of a Saturday morning. Thank